Welcome, everyone. Welcome. Welcome. Welcome.
Welcome.
Can you hear me? How's this? Yes. All right. Welcome, everyone. If there's anyone still out in the back, there are seats up front. So come on up. So before I get to do this wonderful introduction, in addition to Carl McCall, I just wanted to also take a moment and acknowledge Peggy and Don Shriver, who were with us this afternoon, who have been recovering from illnesses, but Don is a former president of Union. So it's wonderful to have a chance to introduce James Cohn. It's a wonderful to do it in any context, but particularly to do it here at his home institution, a place where he has been teaching for 47 years. That qualifies a place as home. And it's wonderful to be doing it here today and seeing a combination of Union students and staff and faculty blending together with many people from the surrounding community who don't, on a regular basis, have the chance to benefit from the brilliance and wisdom and insight and passionate presence of Dr. Cohn. So this is a remarkable gathering today. I'm going to tell you a little bit about him, although all of you know in much detail what a distinguished scholar Dr. Cohn is. He is widely known as the founder of Black Liberation Theology, and he is the Charles A. Briggs Distinguished Professor of Systematic Theology. He got here in 1969. Before that, he attended Shorter College and holds a BA from Philander Smith College. He got his MDiv from Garrett and his MA and PhD from Northwestern. He has a long list, 13 honorary doctorates, and has won numerous awards. Among them are the American Black Achievement Award in Religion, given by Ebony Magazine. And I could begin to list these awards, but then we wouldn't have as much time to hear from Dr. Cohn. He's an ordained minister in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. He's the author of 12 books and over 150 articles. And he has lectured around the world, literally, as I travel as president of Union around the world and visit places as far-flung as Brazil and South Africa and India, China, Korea. When people find out I'm from Union, the first name off their lips is, "Ah, we remember when Dr. Cohn was here. I teach his books." A true international scholar. He's best known in these places around the world for his groundbreaking works, Black Theology and Black Power, 1969, and the standard text in many systematic theology classes, a Black Theology of Liberation. He is author of God of the Oppressed, Martin and Malcolm in America, A Dream or a Nightmare. His research area is in Christian theology, with special attention to Black liberation theology and liberation theologies, and here the global comes back in again in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. His latest book, and if you haven't read it, I urge you to, is a deeply moving and compelling, indeed searing and yet opening social critique entitled The Cross and the Lynching Tree. And in 2012, it received the Nautilus Silver Award in Religion, Spirituality, and Western Tradition. It was this never happens to a theology book. It was an Amazon.com number one bestseller. That never happens, never. And Huffington Post named it one of the top religion books of 2011. All of these statistics and all of these awards and honors and accomplishments don't capture the fullness of this man. To fully capture that, we would need to have the hundreds of students that he has taught and formed over these 47 years here with their lives and their ministry and their prophetic theology bearing witness to what this man has done at Union, in New York City, around the United States, and around the world. Dr. Cohn, thank you.
Thank you. Hello. Thank you. Is this, can you hear me? The volume goes up as I go along. I want to thank President Serene Jones for that wonderful introduction. And it's so wonderful to see one of my presidents also here, Dr. Donald Shriver and his wife Peggy. I am here, and so wonderful to see all of my former students and all the people I know out there. I want to thank you for your presence today. I'm here today because Vice President Fred Davey asked me to conduct a seminar, a lecture on Black liberation theology, primarily for Harlem, New York ministerial community. And I said yes. Black liberation theology is my life ministry. It is not an easy subject for me to teach or to talk about, even though I love teaching and love talking about it, especially at Union Seminary. I wouldn't have stayed so long. So hold on to your seats. Brace yourselves. A version of this lecture you will hear today has been presented at other places, especially in my theology class, Kant and Hegel. But rather the God of the Exodus, the prophets, and of Jesus. If God is in the world, where people are abused and exploited, what then is God doing? This was my question as I wrestled with the fire that was burning inside me. Christians are called by God to plunge themselves into the world on behalf of those who are voiceless and hurt. The great Russian writer Dostoevsky said, quote, "There is only one thing I dread, not to be worthy of my suffering," unquote. As I reflected on that saying in relation to Black suffering, I said, there is only one thing I dread, not to be worthy of the life that the suffering of my Black ancestors have made possible for me. I wanted to be a faithful witness to the redemptive meaning of their nearly 400 years of suffering. I am here at Union Seminary today because my ancestors suffered and died for me and for many others like me. Union Seminary founded in 1836, but not for the freedom of Black people. Black freedom was not a part of his educational ministry. Cain killed his brother Abel, but Abel's blood spoke. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother Abel?" He said, "I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper?" And the Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground." Now, Cain can be viewed as a metaphor for white people, and Abel for black people. God is asking white Americans, especially Christians, where are your black brothers and sisters? And white supremacists respond, "We don't know. Are we their keepers?" And the Lord says, "What have you done to them for 4 centuries? The blood of black people is crying out to God and to whites from the ground in the United States of America. The blood of Sandra Bland in Texas and Tamir Rice in Ohio. The blood of the Emmanuel Nine in Charleston and of Eric Garner on Staten Island. The blood of nearly 5,000 lynched blacks. The blood of Ned Turner, Denmark Vesey, and Gabriel Prosser. And the many thousand gone, millions gone on the auction block and under the lash and during the mill passage. Black blood is crying out to God from the ground all over this land. Is anybody listening to the cries of black blood? That strange fruit that Billie Holiday sang about? Blood on the leaves and blood at the root. The heart of the Christian faith is the cross of Jesus, the one who shed his blood as a crucified victim in Jerusalem. No one can understand the Jesus of Calvary and the saving power of his blood without seeing him through the experiences of crucified people today. No people can understand the transforming power of Jesus except through the complete solidarity with the poor and the wretched in your midst. When that biblical truth became clear to me, my theological transformation from a Negro theologian to a black theologian began to develop and was soon complete. The blood of blacks in America's cities, Watts, Detroit, and Newark, was crying out to God and to white America, crying out for their humanity to be recognized. We declare our rights to be a human being, Malcolm X said, to be respected as a human being on this earth. which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary. In the midst of burning cities, I knew what I had to say, but I did not know whether I had the talent or the courage to say it effectively with the word power that would get the attention of the black community and the white theological world. But I had to try, because I heard the cry of black blood. And like the prophet Jeremiah, within me there was something like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I was weary of holding it in, and I could not. I became obsessed with the cries of black blood and the angry, and became angry, really enraged about the silence of white theologians in their churches. They studied Kant and Hegel, Heidegger, and a host of other Europeans who regarded blacks as inferior and unimportant for philosophical and theological reflection, and thereby rendered black blood insignificant. That was why I began writing about a black theology of liberation with a focus on a critique of white theology and its churches, and the need to do theology with a black signature on it. I wanted to challenge white America and its churches, its theologies. I wanted to challenge them to listen to the cries of black blood. White theology has blood on his hands. The blood of black men, women, and children. Look at your hands, dripping with the blood of your black brothers and sisters, I shouted at them. Look at your bloody hands. I wanted also to inspire blacks to create a new theology out of black blood, crying out to God in the world. We must make a theological starting point, I thought, the shed blood of black people in U.S. history and in the streets of America. And I was mad. My Damascus Road experience, my decisive break with European and American white theologians, happened in the summer of 1967 during the Detroit riot, in which 43 people were shot dead in the streets. I was teaching at Adrian College in Adrian, Michigan, about 70 miles from Detroit. And I heard the voices of black blood crying out to God and to humanity. And all of the anger I had suppressed about white supremacy in Arkansas, at Garrett, and Northwestern, and now at Adrian College, all that suppressed anger burst forth out of me like an erupting volcano. that had been dormant for many years. I felt like a transcendent presence had seized my whole being, which commanded me to write or be consumed by the rage that was in me. And like a wounded boxer, I came out swinging. And white theology and its churches, and I was determined to speak and write the truth that I felt burning inside me. Now Jesus says in the Gospel of Thomas, one of those books that didn't get in the canon, Jesus says, if you bring forth what is within you, what you bring forth will save you. If you do not bring forth what is within you, what you do not bring forth will destroy you. The birth of Black liberation theology was nothing but James Cone bringing forth the Black truth that was burning inside him. I wanted to be saved from white supremacy and not be destroyed by it. It was so liberating when I began to write and people began to listen and read what I was saying. To write a book that people actually read and talk about in churches, seminaries, and the community was an amazing achievement for a young Black in his late 20s who once chopped and picked cotton for $2 a day and 2 cents a pound in the agriculture fields of Arkansas. Black theology and Black power was the first word about the gospel that I brought forth out of me. It was a word which said that Black power is not alien to the gospel, but rather it is the gospel of Jesus in 20th century America. The color of the book is red. This is what it looked like. It's red to symbolize the shed blood. Black people fighting for their humanity. Many people called it the Little Red Book. It momentarily shook up white theologians and their churches. Since I didn't need the approval of my professors anymore, I said what I thought. And not what they wanted me to say. And some of them wouldn't speak to me anymore. Well, I didn't have to be the kind of theologian they wanted me to be. I was free. And I felt that freedom while I was writing Black theology and Black power. In June of 1968, in my brother's church, Union AME in Little Rock, Arkansas, in the wake of the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. King's assassination 2 months earlier deepened my rage as I wrote from 7 a.m. to midnight daily, except on Sundays, for 5 weeks. As I wrote, I listened to the spirituals and remind me for whom I was writing. I felt as if I was under some black spell, wrestling with my vocation as a minister and as a theologian, trying to make myself accountable to a transcendent presence larger and greater than me or my people. I was shocked that I could even write a book. But both blacks and whites were shocked that I had the audacity to identify God and Jesus as black and involved in the black freedom struggle. That's racism in reverse, many whites said. And many blacks agreed with them. They began to ask, who is this Negro? Who calls himself a theologian? Where did he come from? And why is he so angry? They tried to ignore me, especially white theologians. But before whites knew what theological left hook had hit them, I gained a little confidence in my emerging perspective, and I burst forth with the right haymaker, a second volcanic theological eruption, a black theology of liberation in 1970. Which was saturated with more rage than black theology and black power. The dominant color of this one is white. With the word liberation in red and a black cross replacing the letter T in liberation. The red symbolizes the blood of blacks, and the cross recalls the lynching tree on which blacks were put to death. And the color white symbolizes the people who did it. Both books were like militant theological manifestos telling white America that the gospel of Jesus is God's word of liberation to the black poor. Whites had turned Jesus' message into a gospel of white supremacy. A complete contradiction of what the gospel really is. Jesus, a poor Galilean peasant, executed as a criminal by the Roman state, had been transformed into an alabaster Christ who serves the interests of powerful rulers in America and in Europe. Now, the spirituals and the blues in that book, this one, I began my theological journey in the black experience, building on the foundation that I had laid in black theology and black power and a black theology of liberation. The spirit in the spirituals and the blues, I'm wanting to wash my theology in the blood of black people, using slave spirituals and poor slavery blues as my focus. The colors, blue and black, that grace the color of my third book, symbolizes the music and the people who sang it. I was nurtured in the Christian faith singing the spirituals at Macedonia AME Church and took my plunge into black secular faith, listening to the blues blasting forth from the juke junks on Friday and Saturday nights, talking about black blood crying out from the ground. Nothing tells us about the agony of that experience like the spirituals and the blues. What did I do to be so black and blue? A blues man sang. Nobody knows the trouble I seen. Nobody knows my sorrow. Nobody knows the trouble I seen. Glory, hallelujah. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child, a long ways from home. Great God Almighty, folks feeling bad. Lost everything they ever had. Well, the blues ain't nothing but a poor working man feeling bad. Well, it's one of the worst old feelings that any old poor man's ever had. I had to reflect on the pain expressed in black music because it was created out of the shed blood from slavery to the present. It is only in this music, writes James Baldwin, that the Negro in America has been able to tell his story. But Baldwin says it is not a very pretty story. It is a story of pain and suffering. If I were going to write an authentic black liberation theology, I had to let the suffering of black people speak in and through my theology. My theology came out of the black experience of slavery, segregation, and lynching, and not from white American and European theologies that I studied in graduate school. Black liberation theology emerged out of the civil rights and black power movements, symbolized in the life and work of Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X. The black in black theology comes from Malcolm, and the theology comes from Martin. I was trying to hold them together because they had been separated in the 1960s. My first two books were intended to wake up white theologians and slap their faces, as it were, and to arouse them out of a deep theological and philosophical sleep as they were snoring loudly about Bard, Bootman, and Tillich and a host of other European theologians. But with the spirituals and the blues, I turned to the most creative religious source for understanding the gospel of Jesus in American history. This is not an overstatement or hyperbole. If one wants to create an authentic American theology with a Christian identity, one must begin reflecting on the religious experiences of slaves, the crucified people in American history, because the religion of slaves is the closest analogy to the religion of Jesus. Think about that. In the spirituals and the blues, I wanted to wake up black people to arouse them out of a deep spiritual sleep so they could begin to realize that the spirituals and the blues are like treasures hidden in the field which someone found and hid. And then in her joy goes and sells all that she has to buy that field. I was so joyful about what I had found in the spirituals and the blues that I was beside myself. White theological blindness regarding the rich theological source in the black religious experience fueled my passion, which burst forth again in God of the Oppressed. It is a theological knockout punch intended to finish off white theology as a credible interpretation of the Christian gospel. In that book, I saw myself coming of age, feeling a little more confident after many intellectual battles and with white and black theologians asking me about the ground on which I stood. What then was the primary theological claim that I was seeking to advance in those early texts? And how did I discover it? I went first to the Bible and reread it in the light of the black experience as I had learned it as a child at Macedonia AME Church in Bearden. I discovered that the God of the Bible is the liberator of the oppressed of the land. As evidence for that theological claim, I pointed to the exodus of Hebrew slaves out of Egypt, the prophet's message of God's justice for the poor and the weak, and God's solidarity with the poor as revealed in Jesus of Nazareth, the one who was crucified in Jerusalem. Black theology is biblical theology. I was never taught in seminary about God's liberation of the poor in a way that made it accessible as a theological construction. This insight came to me like a God-sent revelation. The point is so simple, so obvious, I felt stupid that I never thought about it as an intellectual point for theology, especially since the insight was clearly expressed in the spirituals and the freedom songs of the civil rights movement. I was too preoccupied with reading white theologians who tricked black seminary students into believing that the truth revealed in the black experience was theologically worthless. If everything one reads in theology is written and taught by whites about their experience, it's easy to conclude that whites are smart, very intelligent, and blacks are dumb, ignorant. I spent 6 years in graduate school, and there was not one assigned theological text written by a black or about the black experience. It was therefore difficult for me to think black when everything about theology was white. I was faced with nearly 2,000 years of white theological thinking about Christianity. It was a daunting task for me to take on the white theological tradition with people like Anselm and Aquinas, Luther and Calvin. You heard of them? Yeah. Bob, Tilly, Niebuhr. How you gonna say black with them?
Yeah. Yeah.
What could I say about the Christian gospel that that could challenge these theological giants? I was not sure. Yet, some Charlie Cone rose up in me. That's my daddy. And urged me to accept the challenge of white theology and to soak my theology in blackness with liberation at the center.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now that conviction opened my eyes to see Jesus as the liberator, as the most important theological affirmation of the gospel. For Jesus is God's Son, who lived and taught and died for the liberation of the oppressed. Jesus' cross is God's paradox, God entering history as weak and powerless, taking the form of a slave, becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. That's in Philippians 2, if y'all don't know. The cross prevents dominant people anywhere, any place, of any color, from accepting the gospel of Jesus. No one can put people on crosses like the lynching tree in America and still understand and embrace the true meaning of Jesus' cross. The Holy Spirit is God's spirit of liberation, who empowers poor people not only to jump and shout, but also to fight for freedom when the odds are against them. The Holy Spirit is God's presence in the lives of poor people all over this world. I saw the Spirit of God at work in the civil rights and black power movements during the 1960s. Empowering black people to demand their right to be free. It was an amazing sight to see African Americans marching and singing, "We shall overcome. We won't turn back. We don't fear no ways tired. We come too far from where we started from. Nobody told us it would be easy. We don't believe that God brought us this far to leave." The Black Freedom Struggle was both tragic and beautiful. Tragic and beautiful. The beauty was found in the resistance and in the joy are struggling for justice. And the tragedy was the suffering and the death, like the death of Emmett Till in the Tallahatchie River, which paradoxically ignited the civil rights movement. And like the killing of the four innocent girls in the Birmingham church. But despite the absurdity of that demonic act, made black people more determined to fight until freedom comes. There was and still is a fire burning in the black community and in me, and nobody can put it out. There was no way for Christian blacks to explain the source of their courage to face the continued brutality of white supremacy, except by pointing to God's liberating presence in their lives, empowering them to believe that they could indeed transform America into the nation that it ought to be. I had to write to redeem myself for being in a seminary classroom and a library reading European theologian while black people were out in the street risking their lives for my freedom. I had to pay my dues. As Baldwin said, the bill had come due. And after reading the Bible in the context of the black struggle for justice, I boldly asserted that white theology is not Christian theology, because it's a language of white supremacy. To understand Christian identity from a dominant white point of view is like trying to understand Jesus from a dominant Roman point of view. Pause and think about that now. America is like the Roman Empire. And even many biblical scholars say that. Like Rome, America is dominant and white. Jesus was a Palestinian Jew, and his community was an oppressed minority like black people in the United States. There's no way that Roman intellectuals and politicians could understand and embrace the meaning of Jesus of Nazareth. When Pilate summoned Jesus and asked, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I'm a king. For this I was born. And for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Then Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" As a typical philosopher intellectual. See, yeah. Now he asked that question from a philosophical and a Roman point of view. Pilate had no way of knowing that the truth of Jesus was talking about was standing before him. The same is true of white intellectuals and politicians in America. When I say Jesus is black and God is black, white theologians were outraged and thought I lost my theological mind. It was my way of saying that Jesus was a Jew and God is identified with the oppressed. This is not a literal statement about skin color. It is not a statement about biology. It's a symbolic, poetic statement about God. Like saying Jesus is a rock in a weary land, a lily of the valley and the bright and morning star. The truth which is revealed in Christ must be apprehended with faith. And faith draws on poetic and imaginative capacities rather than rational ones. That was why Reinhold Niebuhr said people without imagination should not even talk about God. God and the imagination are one, writes the great poet Wallace Stevens. Theology talk about God is symbolic language, as the theologian Paul Tillich rightly emphasized. It is a language of imagination. And black preachers know something about imagination and proclamation. One needs spiritual knowledge to understand what it means to say Jesus is black or God is black. God is always found where we don't expect, like in a manger in Bethlehem, or on a cross in Jerusalem, or hanging from a lynching tree in America. I began to write because I had no choice. Writing about black liberation theology was my way of seeing and living, my way of feeling and thinking, my way of responding to the black blood crying out in the wilderness in America. I write theology the way I feel it in my flesh and bones. And you can't imagine what it means to say what you've always wanted to say, and to say it precisely to the people you wanted to say it to. I turned to black poets like Richard Wright and James Baldwin to help me to find the words to say what I wanted to say. No one, Jesus said, puts new wine in old wineskins, or tears a piece of new cloth and sews it onto an old garment. Jesus was talking about the newness of his teachings when compared to John the Baptist. I felt a similar way about black liberation theology. It was like new wine, new garment, a new language. I could not just sew it on to white American and European theology, which was shaped by white supremacy. And I started saying things that people weren't supposed to say publicly, especially about race. In a way, I sort of touched on it accidentally. I had no plan to. Just touched on a secret, hidden core about race and Christianity in America. The core is no one is expected to speak and write honestly about race and the Christian gospel. And I learned that when I rub the truth in their faces, whites shook and trembled, didn't know what to do. And this little tiny insight gave me a clue to hit them harder while I had them on the ropes. For I was fighting for the voiceless in the black community. People who would never have a chance to talk to you. Black liberation theology was not something that I made up. Goes back to Macedonia AME Church, founded in Bearden in the 1880s. It goes back even further, way back to slavery, when an ex-slave, Richard Allen, and other blacks walked out of St. George Methodist Church in Philadelphia and founded the African Methodist Episcopal Church. In 1860, Sandwich is celebrating its bicentennial year. Black theology goes back to Henry Highland Garnett, that great Presbyterian black minister who proclaimed to slaves in 1843, "Let your motto be resistance." Resistance. Where is the blood of your fathers? Has it run out of your veins? This is the black religious tradition, the well of black theological wisdom from which I drank and wrote black liberation theology. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? This question was asked about Jesus because Nazareth was a small village in first century Palestine and was regarded as too unimportant to be the place of the Messiah's birth. In an analogous way, black people's religious history and culture was regarded as too insignificant to give birth to Christian theology. The assumption that black people could think of that we have, you know, the assumption was that black people could not think and that we did, that we had an inferior mind was rooted deep in American and European history. And this inferiority projected onto black people was used to justify their slavery. Even the great Reinhold Niebuhr thought blacks were inferior and backwards. I came here to tell him that's not true. That was initially why so few whites and blacks took black liberation seriously. This is a theology that comes from slaves, sharecroppers, janitors, and maids. You don't expect theology to come from there. And that was why people thought black theology is intellectually and theologically unimportant. But they were wrong. Black liberation theology is still alive and well. Now, the cross and the lynching tree is my latest witness to the blood dripping down through the leaves. Pain so old and deep and black and particular. By far, the cross and the lynching tree is the most agonizing book I have written. I had nightmares during the 10 years I was writing it. I realized that I could have been that strange fruit that Billie Holiday sang about. I could have been that. My father and my brothers and even my mothers could have been black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Writing is a form of prayer, wrote Franz Kafka in his diary. The cross and the lynching tree is my prayer, my invocation to God on behalf of black people in the hope that their nearly 400 years of suffering will be redempted for their children and grandchildren, revealing to them the beauty in their tragic past. And I think Black Lives Matter is a partial realization of that hope. It is also my hope that whites too will be redeemed from their blindness and made to open their eyes to the terror of their deeds, so they will know that we are all of one blood, and that what they do to black people, they do to themselves. Thank you.
I'm just glad you said yes when we asked you to do it. And I said it was going to be historic, but I had no idea what I was talking about. But indeed, it was and is. You inspired me in 1978 when I went to start at seminary in Richmond. I remember going to my theology professor, I won't call his name, and I said, I want to study liberation theology, and particularly black liberation theology, and I want to read James Cone, because they weren't reading it at Union Seminary in Richmond, Virginia, Union Presbyterian Seminary. Theologian said, head of theology department said, Fred, it's an ideology, not a theology, and it'll have no place in this seminary. I left. To go somewhere where they would let me read you, Dr. Cone. And I've been reading you ever since, so God bless you and thank you. Thank you for this. We all owe you a debt of deep, deep gratitude. So thank you. So Dr. Cone has agreed to take some questions. We'll do this until about 2:30, and our own Reverend Dr. Derek Harkins, who's a Union alum and now a senior VP here at Union Seminary, has agreed to moderate this part of the conversation. So, Derek.
Again, good afternoon. What I'm going to ask so we can facilitate this smoothly is those of you who have some questions you'd like to offer up. There's a microphone here, and I see this one here. I just want to, and there's one. Why don't we just do this? Is it possible for us to put that one in the middle, sort of cross out? Does that work okay for you? And then that way we don't have to worry about everybody navigating all the way to the very front. That might be a little difficult. Perfect. And if you have questions already, why don't you begin to move toward those microphones, and let me just ask you this one indulgence. We've been inspired by the profound words of Dr. Cone. In honor of that, the brevity of your questions would give the greatest homage to the power of his words. I know I got a bunch of preachers in here, so... And as we begin, let me just say this. I have to say this, Fred, you share this. Over the course of years, God has blessed me immeasurably. I first came to know James Cone as a profound theologian who I admired from afar. I then came to know James Cone as my professor of systematic theology. I've come to now know and cherish him as a colleague and brother beloved. God is a good God over all of these years. Amen. Our first question.
Thank you. I must personally thank you for being a student and writing my own South Bronx Theology of Liberation and a newsletter with the tag Seeking Communal Salvation Through the Struggles of Social Justice. Now my question, now that you have thoroughly destroyed white theology and the white Christian church in theology, have you thought about going after the institutional church? As you look, as you go to any of the thousands of churches in America, or my church across the street, there's nothing in the program that says, Liberation Theology Sermon. There's flower funds, there's progressives, but the institutional church is maintaining churches as they are, totally disconnected from liberation. So I'd like to see you go after that.
Well, I've gone after some. I would ask you to take a look at My Soul Looks Back. That's me going after my own church.
Very good.
Yes. Because I do think institutions have a great deal of difficulty following in the steps of Jesus. See, the problem with institutions is that they spend too much time trying to save themselves.
That's right. Maintain themselves at all costs.
And they forget that Jesus said, if you're going to save your life, you got to lose it for those who are weak. But it's hard for institutions to do that.
Absolutely.
It is. That's why you need theologians and prophets to remind them of what the true calling is. And so in some sense, I have been doing that all my life. You just join me.
If we just need to rev it up. Thank you. God bless.
Good afternoon. My name is Gabby Cudgel-Wilkes. I'm a current MDiv student at Yale Divinity School.
At where?
At Yale Divinity.
Oh, Yale Divinity.
Yes, and thank you for your talk. Quick question. How do you theologically respond to African Americans who ask the question, if God is such an omnipotent God, why not just have black people free? Why do we need a liberator? Why do we have to struggle? Why isn't that just a part of our DNA?
Yeah, that's a good question. I teach a class about that. I do. I teach a class about that. I just want to say, you know, suffering gives rise to faith. It gives rise to it. Without faith, black people wouldn't have survived. It sustains you. And I know something about that. But at the same time, suffering contradicts faith. That's what you point out. You have to learn how to live with that tension. You don't want to give up faith. Yet at the same time, you don't want to take it for granted and let it blind you to the suffering in your midst. That doubt that you have, that suffering raises for you, is what keeps your faith alive. Because you get too complacent. And so wake up every day knowing the only hand God has for fighting against suffering is your hand. So don't lose faith. Let it empower you. Let it take. And I would just say to you, you know, I saw that in the civil rights movement. The more difficult it became, the deeper that faith was. And so you still young. You got a long ways to go. But hold on! If you read Tillich's Dynamics of Faith, where he says there, makes the point there, that
Doubt is indispensable for faith. It deepens it. All these fundamentalists out there who think they're so sure about everything, you want to avoid them. Doubt is what makes that faith deep, makes you faint, makes you wrestle, makes you feel it all over. But over yonder, it'll be resolved. It'll be resolved one day. Okay, thank you.
Let's do the far mic and then
we'll hi. As somebody who is very concerned about unity in the body of Christ,
yes,
I want to ask some tough questions. Number one, how much longer will your black blood cry out from the grounds? What will it take to satisfy this black blood? Number two, when are we going to realize the ideal of Martin Luther King, to judge people not by their color of skin, which I heard a lot about today, but to judge them about their character? And I say this because I feel that a lot of talk on this subject is needlessly divisive. If you had been giving this talk back in 1960, I would probably amen the whole thing. But I see that today things have turned around almost diametrically. A white person would not be able to come up there and talk about racism against black people in the same way that you're able to talk about whites. I find your talk needlessly divisive. There are many other things that I could bring up now, but I won't. And I wonder also about this institution that gives audience or gives stage to these types of talks. Thank you.
Let me just say, as we ask these questions, there's never a point at which we should broach the issue of respect. So please make sure that any questions asked with that measure of respect that anybody is due. Doctor.
Yeah, I we live in different worlds. We do. And I do understand what you're saying. I really do. But we're in different worlds. I don't know what can help you. I don't know what can help you. I'm okay, you know. I don't have much longer on this earth. Don't have much more. I just thank God for the ministry. It's my call. My call. Everybody got a call. I don't know what yours is. I'm not sure that was it, but I'm not sure that was it. Well, I don't want to engage in a back and forth. But I just say we in different worlds, and I leave it at that.
Dr. Cone.
Yes.
I admire you so much and have admired you for the past 40 plus years. Thank God for this day, and thank God for your consent to do this for us today. I have a two-part question. Number one.
First of all.
What can we as a people, black and white in America, do to bring this to a reality that we can all realize this to fruition? What can we do together? That's the first part. And secondly, how long would you think that it would take at the rate it's going at?
Well, you know, I think we've been working. Yeah. We have been working. It's a small group. Remember, Jesus had a small group.
Amen.
See, it wasn't a big crowd. As long as there is a witness somewhere, mm-hmm. and people are embodiments of that witness, then there is hope.
All right.
Hope is in the resistance. It's in the witness. I understand. A lot of people say, you know, it ain't getting no better. No, it's not, in some sense. But in a lot of sense, it is, because we're getting better.
That's right.
And how to define it, how to fight it. Because sin is clever.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And we find a lot of ways to blind ourselves to the hurt of others. So I would want to say, the more I see black people and white people in the same room,
mm-hmm.
walking down the same street.
Amen. Amen.
And struggling with the same thing, that's hope.
That's right. Thank you, Doc.
So I don't know how long it's going to take. I don't know. King said not long.
No.
But he's gone. He's gone. So in a certain sense, it's not long, in the sense that we are bearing witness to what is really possible.
Thank you, Doc.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hello, Dr. Cohn.
Yes.
My name is Richard Williams. I'm a recent MA theology graduate at St. John's, and I'm going for my MDiv at Candler in the fall. And I'd like to first say that I find your work not divisive, but unifying, because it has unified a community that's desperately in need of unity. With that, my question is, Black liberation theology was created partly to be the prophetic arm that the black churches have kind of
yes.
moving away from. Throughout your work into the present day, do you see the black churches of today being more prophetic? And if not, how can more black churches come together with black theologians in a way that godly reflection can be used at its maximum source?
I think there are some churches I've seen which are prophetic. Some ministers, not the institution, but some ministers in spite of the institution. But that was true during King's time. He didn't have the institution. Because J.H. Jackson didn't like him at all and fought against him every way. And most preachers didn't like him. So he had a small group. So I still think there are small groups that rise up and bear witness in Ferguson, in Baltimore, a few other places that we don't even know about. I just hope we can get some more theologians too to bear the same kind of witness so we can, you know, so we can keep alive the fire that is burning, especially in the young people today.
Thank you.
I'm interested in your views on the Catholic Church and its reaction to liberation theology.
Oh, the Catholic Church. You know, I've said something about that in theological studies. A special edition was done in theological studies in, I think, the year of 2000, celebrating Black Theology of Liberation, where I responded to Catholic theology and Black theology. I think it's about like other white theologians. It ain't too much different. I think Catholics seem to be more tight. And what they believe, they don't have a place for somebody like me. See, they wouldn't like me. See, because I'm not controllable.
All right.
You follow what I mean? I'm going to say anything. And that's where that Protestant principle comes in. You know, that freedom. I won't be silenced. Catholic Church goes around silencing people. Silenced my friend Gustavo Gutierrez once. And Leonardo Bach.
So one difference is they wouldn't like my rebellion. I certainly wouldn't let nobody silence me. Nobody's gonna shut me up. So that would be one difference. That would be one difference. But I admit, I have a lot of theologians I get along with well who are Catholic, especially black Catholics. People like Sean Copeland, who's teaching at Boston College. She's the one who organized theological studies for a special issue on the black theology of liberation. So it's there. It's published in Theological Studies. And it was presented at the Catholic Theological Society in 2000. Okay.
I see we've got time for about these final two questions, and so I'm going to invite you to ask yours, and then we'll conclude.
Thank you.
Okay.
My name is Hassan Xavier Henderson Lott, a senior religion major at Morehouse College in Atlanta, Georgia.
Oh, okay.
My question follows. Delman Coates made a claim at Morehouse a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
And he made a distinction between the black church and churches with black people in them that perpetuate white supremacy.
Yeah.
What is your reaction to this? And then what is your call to action? What is your response to black churches that do support and perpetuate white supremacist ideals?
Yeah, I think he's right about that. There are some who do that. That's why I started writing in the first place. And you can take a look at it in My Soul Looks Back. It's where I talk about that more directly. But yeah, I think there's a lot of critique of the black church because, like most institutions, they're engaged in survival mode. And that makes them more comfortable with white supremacy because they have a place within it. And as long as you're doing fine, you won't want to upset what is in the status quo. So I think there is some truth to that. But I think with, young radical, young ministers, you can change that. That's what I tried to do. And my church tried to silence me, but nobody silences me. So I have to work on the margins of the AME church. The margin. Don't worry, they're not going to invite me to speak. Because I will tell them off, and they know it. So, yeah, I agree with Coates on that.
I know I'm next, but I'd like to defer to my dear brother, Don Shriver.
All right.
And then if I still could squeeze a question in, I would be grateful.
Yeah.
All right. Former president of Union Seminary. Dear friend.
Thank you, dear friend. After 21 years as your colleague in this place, I should already know the answer. And I apologize for asking a question which is already answering what you've said so eloquently here this afternoon, but that's the way it goes. I have a friend who has just recently left for the heavenly kingdom, who when he learned I was being appointed as president of this place, he said, well, in order to do that job, you may have to pray a lot. And in my agreement with him, especially my first several years here, I found myself borrowing in my mind phrases from the culture of black churches like keeping on, keeping on, and I'm going to lay my burden on the Lord, and I will go to see what the end will be.
Yes.
I guess my question to you, and I apologize for not just underlining what you already said, what keeps us keeping on, keeping on.
Oh, yeah, that's a good question. Yeah,
the lost stuff has not happened that you've been in favor of happening. So, What's your answer to a fellow Christian? What is it keeps us keeping on?
Well, I think that's where faith comes in. Faith. As I said, faith, suffering, difficulty, contradiction, gives rise to faith. Faith sustains people when the going gets tough. See, that's why I say the black religious experience has so much to teach white America about how to sustain yourself in the struggle. It is faith. It's faith. And that is a gift. Faith is not something you just get. It's a gift of grace. And that's the only thing that keeps me going. Because it's so easy to think more of yourself than you ought to think. Everybody keeps telling me what great you are and all that. Well, so it's faith that keeps you humble and keeps you going no matter how difficult it is. I saw that in Martin Luther King Jr. Whole civil rights movement there. And I see it in Black Lives Matter. I see it wherever poor people are struggling. I've seen it all over the world. And I would just look. In the Philippines, I saw it. In Latin America, I saw it. In Africa, I saw it. How do you keep struggling when it seems like you're not going nowhere? It's faith that empowers you to keep on keeping on. I heard that at Macedonia AME Church, because in the South in the 40s and 50s where I grew up, white people had all the power. But every Sunday, we knew of a power they did not know about. Sustained us. And let us know that we were not what they said we were. Yeah. That's why I'm standing here. That's why I'm standing here. So I would say it's that faith. Yes, one last thing, and we go.
Thank you again, Dr. Cohn. And I want to assure you, and I know you know this, many white philosophers and theologians have been listening, saying amen, and being encouraged and inspired, if not also supported. I'm a Christian philosopher, head of New York Divinity School. My challenge is this. Our heart goes out to people who are oppressed every place.
Yes.
In our time, so utterly tragically, people of faith are being martyred.
Yes, yes, yes.
Oppressed.
Yes.
In increasing
yes.
numbers.
Yes.
And I know this can't be a short answer, but could you give us a couple of words of wisdom or encouragement how we can pray for them, what we can do to speak up?
We have for to them. See ourselves in those who suffer. That's it. You suffer when other people suffer. When you can see, it's the problem I had. I saw that growing up. What I saw is how white people in Beard and Arkansas didn't see themselves in us. That's why they treated us so bad. They saw themselves in that patch better than they saw themselves in us. So I think people hurt in a kind of brutal, unlimited way because they don't see themselves in those they hurt. And what the gospel does. You cannot be for the man from Nazareth unless you see yourself in the neighbor, in those who are low and who are hurt. So that's the only clue. And that's why we need people who will preach the gospel.
So just quick word, we're going to do a benediction, we're going to go. I don't know what more can be said. I guess no more can be said. Except I hear the words of Derek Bell in his book, Slaves at the Bottom of the, Slaves at the Bottom of the Well, Faces at the Bottom of the Well, where he said, black slaves said surrender is not an option. And that's what I hear from you today, that surrender clearly is not an option for us, but faith is going to keep us going. I want to thank Ron Wellington again, because had his black blood not cried out for this day, it may not have happened. Just a preacher among preachers who said, I want to hear from Dr. James Cone, and we got him. So thank you. We're going to ask Reverend Harkins to dismiss us. And then we thank you all for coming. We hope to see you back here again real soon. Derek.
Reverend Dr. James Hal Cone, you are indeed a gracious gift. And for that, we are truly thankful. Shall we join our hearts? God of sustained grace, God of unwavering faithfulness, God of unlimited power, and God of yet fulfilled glory, we thank you for this hour. We thank you for the robustness of the gift that you have shaped and fashioned by that of your servant. Give him succor and strength. Continue to allow his voice to be a clarion for justice and liberation. And speak into each of our hearts, and as we depart from this place, but never from your presence, may that very blood yet still cry out and cause us to seek to serve you justly all the days of our lives. In your gracious and sustaining name, we do indeed pray. And let all of God's people say, amen. Bless you.